hopefully. Hopefully it's the Yeti microphone. Because I don't want it to pick up so much gain, you know, that it's not.
Thank you. Tonight's performer, as well as giving you a little bit more info about the program. But I just wanted to say in general, this is the first of the Convergence Research events that we'll be hosting this academic year. We've been so excited. We've had this program running for about 2 years now. Let's just mention, there are more chairs around the corner, so please feel free to grab some. Melissa will get a little bit more about the format of how you'll be moving midway through this performance. I just wanted to say a little bit more about Convergence Research. It was a program born out of our desire to really support interdisciplinary conversations here at the University of Houston. We love when artists work with musicians, work with theater people, work with dance, work with architecture, film, design, and so on. And so I wanted the Blackford to create that platform where UH students, faculty, alumni could come together and try ideas out. They could be in any state of development, any state of becoming, but we just wanted to be that kind of experimental laboratory space to really support this type of work at the University of Houston. We presented more finished products than not here, and we've just seen our audiences continue to grow. So it's really so encouraging, so we're so glad that you are all here to support. Thank you. It means a great deal for us, for the performers, so thank you for being part of this. So I think at this point I'll hand it off to Melissa now just to tell a little bit about added details on the program.
Yeah, so the program is directed and kind of facilitated by me through the Mitchell Center, and we utilize an arts and leadership master's student to curate this program. So they get to learn all aspects from finding artists to getting all their information on social media and, every aspect of this performance. And this year, Donald Raven, who's sitting over here in the corner, doing all the filming, so that's another thing, he's live streaming this. Every aspect they get to do of the production of the Convergence Research. So it's a really great experience for those students. The Cynthia Woods Mitchell Center serves as a place of convergence for the College of the Arts. Our mission is to support and bring together all of the staff, faculty, students within the college, support interdisciplinary conversation and projects, as well as reaching out of our college, which we really want to try and do more of. We support visiting artist programs, scholarships and fellowships, performances, exhibitions, as well as Tonight, we're very excited to have a student from the Moore School of Music. Hannah Deplazes is a master's student in cello at the School of Music. She's originally, I'm going to read at this point because I don't have that memorized. She's originally from North Dakota. She graduated from Minot State University in 2021 with a degree in cello performance. And she has studied cello from the age of 8 with many teachers in the United States and Germany. She's attended many summer festivals. She's also competed in competitions like the MTNA and the national, this is German. Okay, I don't know how to say that. But she's won many competitions as well. And she's an active solo performer and member of the Tamat String Quartet. So tonight's performance has two parts. And Hannah will talk to you more about how she thought about this performance, specifically with the music. She was inspired and really studied the artwork in the space, and she'll talk more about this. This is sort of a performative performance talk and performance. And so she'll be entering and performing, talking a little bit, and then at some point she'll tell all of us to move to the next area, and we'll all get up and move to the other side of this piece of art, and there'll be a second movement of the piece. Okay?
Yeah, and I just wanted to quickly, I should have mentioned this, Hannah may mention more about this, but just a little bit about the exhibition that you're sitting in right now. This is Nick Vaughan and Jake Margolin. It's a show called Wayfinding. There is information on the labels and the title wall panel, but in brief, Nick and Jake are partners in both art and life. They are now based in Houston. They originally come from an experimental theater background and essentially have migrated into the arena of visual art, but very much sort of bring theatrical cargo and influence with them in the art of storytelling. And so we're in the midst of a series of what they call wind drawings, where they draw upon archival materials, photos, they turn them into stencils, they put charcoal powder onto pieces of paper, and then they draw essentially with air compressors by moving the charcoal on and across and off the pages. And it's part of a much larger body of work called 50 States, where they look for unheralded, overshadowed, and often forgotten stories of LGBTQ love and romance in every one of the 50 states in the United States of America. And they do very non-linear, kind of anecdotal research to find those stories and then communicate and retell them through a various form of art making. So if you do enjoy Nick and Jake's work, they have two performance lectures coming up, September 28th and October 6th. You can get more info on our website. And they also have other pieces on the UH campus, at the Honors College, at the Worthen Theater Lobby, and at the Art and Architecture Library. So I just wanted to add in a few of those.
Yes, and Hannah will talk a little bit more also about those components. So, we'll give it to her now.
All right, we'll go to Hannah.
Yes.
Thank you. tonight for this wonderful research and experimental performance, but I'm really excited. So as the introduction showed you how the art was made, instead of air and charcoal, for me I have my cello and the music to follow and make art out of sound. I found this wonderful quote that really fit the occasion. It states, "Music is the medium through which we express our feelings of joy and sorrow, love and patriotism, penitence and praise. It is the charm of the soul, the instrument that lifts mind to higher regions, the gateway into the realms of imagination. It makes the eye to sparkle, the pulse to beat more quickly. It causes emotions to pass over being like waves over the far-reaching sea." You may have noticed on your way in an image of a cell tower. When I saw the cell tower, I imagined information being relayed in and out almost instantaneously throughout the world. I've chosen a selection from Alexander Tcherepnin's Solo Cello Suite that I felt relayed this excitement and energy as well.
Thank you.
and perhaps the accompanying ones as well. There's a train car and then a map of roads. But the piece coming up next is the Prelude to Bach's C minor suite. And like, as a train gets moving, it's very difficult to stop. It goes and goes. And as is life, it goes. You can't stop. And in life, everyone faces hardships and struggles, but there are also beautiful, loving moments to cherish. So it's not all doom and gloom. But I think this prelude, it starts off with very dark colors, but there are moments of hope and rays of sunshine to hear as well.
Thank you.
ladies. For me, all means two little boys playing with toys, and it's crazy. But it's a very playful and exciting energy at home. And the second movement of Tcherepnin's cello suite, I think, exudes a very exciting, playful mood as well.
Thank you.
Fantastic performance, by the way. I saw, just a quick question for myself, I saw you were like dancing a little bit, especially for the last piece. And so what were like some of the ideas that you had with the movement, with some of what you did, and especially walking in for the opening?
I think walking in, I wanted to imitate the charcoal moving over the paper. So with the air moving, the charcoal is moving. So when I pause to take a breath, the charcoal also paused. And then I continued on, just as like the art was created, moving it around. So, yeah, that was the main idea. And then I did some motion with the cell tower. This was supposed to be like cell waves coming in and out, and then representing the vastness of this panel, like feeling your inside.
So not sure if members of the audience know, but what sort of chair are you sitting on, and why is it this type of chair?
Oh, well, this is a cello chair from Moore School. It's like a padded to make it a little more comfortable to sit for long periods of time through rehearsals, and it's also level. If you notice, your chairs are slightly leaned back. But as a cellist, if you're leaning back when you're trying to play, then you're fighting against your own body, and it gets very uncomfortable. So having a level chair where you can sit forward and be engaged is ideal.
And last question for me. What were some of the inspirations? How did you come up with the creative experience for the audience with some of the pieces that you chose that represented these different art pieces of art?
I came and observed just the art to get ideas of what I wanted. And the ones that I specifically called out were the ones that stuck out to me and that I had quick ideas with the music that I've either been introduced to or played in the past that I felt would fit the feelings I was experiencing when looking.
Well, I would love to take this time, take this moment to field the audience for some questions. Does anybody have questions for Hannah for a spectacular performance? Stephen?
Hannah, so in the format of this performance, you saw the visuals and then you responded with music. I'm wondering, when you play music, do you ever have visuals? Like, do you ever see things as you're performing? Sort of in your head, or does it ever inspire or evoke visions or visuals for you?
Definitely. I think that's one of the main things I try to do, is find an image or an experience or emotion that I want portrayed through the music, and I imagine that. And then I adjust technique and different things to match that. My teacher, Mr. Katai,
I have a question about a lot of the works that you chose and the pieces that you chose were of different time periods, but a lot of times I felt like maybe the connection you were drawing to the work was involving storytelling. Is that of interest to you?
You mean telling stories from music?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's one thing that can keep music very engaging, is having a story to go with it. If you had a piece that maybe didn't have different characters or different things going on, it would maybe just sound kind of level, like nothing's really happening. So I think adding a story creates a new experience.
So that last piece that you did was very improvisational feeling. So do you feel like with the cello specifically that allows for improvisation in your own work and how you tell the story of the pieces?
Definitely. Yes. I know there's several cellos who make their career off of improvising, and the cellist who wrote this, I listened to one of his recordings in preparation, and his recording doesn't match what's written because he's added things and improvised. And of course, there's certain parameters that a musician is expected to play in different time periods. But I think to a certain extent, you can take liberties and add your own ideas as well.
Any other questions?
So all of the pieces that you played, I really loved. I loved how it kind of changed the feeling and the mood when you were looking at the photo or the pieces. But I really loved the duet that you played with it, because I didn't know a cello could make those two sounds at once. And just hearing it through the whole piece was just lovely. And it just evoked the whole feeling of that.
Playing in this space and the acoustics and how it's different from, say, a practice room, which is a smaller space and not as echoey, maybe?
Yeah, of course. This is definitely a different acoustic than I'm normally playing in. I would describe it as resonant or boomy. You can hear my voice echoing even. So I tried to shorten some louder sounding notes to help combat having it drown out the entire room and not being able to hear like the following notes. And especially with the pizzicatos in some areas, because I know some strings will resonate more. For example, this one is really loud. So I tried to just highlight the ones I wanted more so that the strings that ring more don't cover something else up, which was an interesting challenge because in a practice room, it's very small, the sound doesn't go very far. So you feel like you have to work really hard and press into the instrument, and it's really intense just to get the sound because it's just kind of dead. So it was a lot of fun performing in here because I didn't have to work very hard. It just happens. Yeah.
Final questions? Questions? And one last one. What is the technique of performing two notes at the same time? What is that?
So it has to do with the level of the bow and the strings. If I play on one string, my bow is kind of centered on that one, so it just sounds. But it's like, you take it, if I have two strings like this is one string, and I just tilt it until I hit both.